Well, thank you all for joining us today. I think that our annual open house is one of the events that I most look forward to every year, to be able to visit with all of you, and especially to honor our participants that have been a part of this study for more than 5, 10, 20, and sometimes 30 years. So we regret not to be able to have each of you stand up and give special thanks today, but we realize it has been almost a year since we provided you with an update. So we've packed our normal half day open house into 1 hour to try to make sure that we get out a little bit of information to you about what we've been up to. And thank you for all of the questions that were submitted in advance. We have some of our team members that are going to help to get all of your questions answered. And if you have questions during a presentation, we'd like to ask you to use the chat function. The chat function, you'll see right at the bottom toolbar, there's a little window that says chat. If you write your questions in there, one of our team members will help to keep track of the questions at the end of each speaker's presentation. We'll have a chance to answer those. Hi, Nadine. Thank you. That's great. So today we have an exciting agenda prepared for you. Dr. Brewer, the center director, will give you an overview of what we've been up to in the last year. And we'll have a presentation from Dr. Galasco about biomarkers and research updates and time for questions and answers about new developments in biomarkers. Dr. Salmon is going to give us an update on cognitive testing, including some of the work that we've done during this remote work period at the center. And Dr. Feldman will give us an update on what's been happening in clinical trials. And last but not least, Tracy will let us all know about the ongoing opportunities that we have to get together and visit and provide each other with support. So I think without further ado, I'll ask Dr. Brewer to go ahead and get started. Thank you.
Well, thanks very much, Emily. And I'm so glad to see all the familiar faces here. It's just been way too long that we've not been able to get together. And I'm so glad to see you safe and healthy at this time. What a year it's been. It really has been highlighting the dedication of this team that we have, which I'm so proud to have in this group, because it is remarkable how the team came together and adapted to the challenges of COVID. The first thing we needed to do in the lockdown was to figure out how we can keep our processes going, keep moving forward towards a understanding of this disease and therapies for this disease, and not let COVID knock that progress out. And I think this team, with all of its dedication, really took that challenge. And I think we came so much closer together through this process, because the first thing we did is try to make sure that our cohort was safe. We brought all of our team members together to figure out how we might be able to contact our cohort members and make sure that they were doing well. Because as you remember, at the beginning of the pandemic, there was a lot of angst about this lockdown, what it meant, what we were going to do. And in fact, in some of those phone calls to our cohort members, we did identify some food insecurity issues. And luckily, our team members, with the social worker of Tracy Trescott, were able to kind of intervene and make sure that our cohort were linked up with the resources that they need. So I was very, very proud of how this Alzheimer's Center came together to adapt to the challenges. So thank you all. And I look forward to our ability to get back together. I'll just give a little bit of an update here. And the first thing I always like to show is this remarkable environment that we're in, not only this intellectual environment, but the community environment and the opportunities that it brings. Over here on the left of this picture, this is an overview of the entire UC San Diego campus in the La Jolla area. And wonderfully, with our change, even though it was a very painful change to move from the La Jolla Village professional building to the campus. This has been has brought us a lot of great opportunities with this large Altman Clinical Translational Research Institute, which is just a short walking distance away from the Alzheimer's Disease Research Center, where our clinical trials can make use of the infrastructure of this center, as well as our local infrastructure in the clinic that we have at the ADRC. The other thing that you may have noticed is that we've co-localized with a multidisciplinary memory clinic so that we can permit care of patients with Alzheimer's disease and other memory impairment, and make use of the fact that our research endeavor is very synergistic with the clinical endeavor. In fact, a lot of the resources that the Shiloh Marcos ADRC brings to its participants could be very valuable for patients seeking help, support groups, caregiver information. And this co-localization was actually quite helpful during the pandemic as well, because we learned a lot about what we could do safely, because the hospital system needed to keep running. And it also brought our center to a wider attention with the leadership of the hospital, so that we got resources to help keep the place sanitized and essentially the staff that could keep this center running. Now, as you know, we moved to virtual. Let's go ahead and go to the next slide. We moved to virtual visits in order to keep this operation going. So this is kind of my slide to kind of show in one picture what our ADRC means to do. We need to engage the community, and we do that through this outreach recruitment and engagement core that tries to get the local community aware of Alzheimer's research and to participate. To add the diversity of that, and what we're really making a major effort for, is to increase our outreach to the South Bay of the San Diego region. And we've added a Latino core, as many of you know from our last update, to help diversify the cohort and understand genetic and other cultural features that impact that community differently for neurodegenerative illness. When we bring you into this center, we do not necessarily require that you enter the longitudinal cohort. We'd actually like to support individuals who maybe don't want to give that large commitment to entering the longitudinal cohort for yearly follow-ups. We have a registry that then allows our referrals to go directly to our research affiliates. And even though those individuals are not as well characterized as our participants who enter the longitudinal cohort, they're still quite valuable for our research affiliates, because some of the studies don't require such extensive characterization of the participants, and they're still needed for research studies. So that's a nice thing to tell your colleagues and friends about, to help make sure that they are aware of our operations. And then bring them in. But if people do want to participate in the longitudinal cohort, we have an entire set of operations, as you're very familiar with, that allow us better characterization. Let's go ahead and move forward. As I mentioned, we've made a rapid transition to remote operations. One of the things that this pandemic helped allow us to focus on is to step back from our daily operations and see what places might need tuning up. For example, the registry or other aspects of our center. We established task forces so that we could assess not only the needs that related to the pandemic, but other needs, and to enact change. And I think that was a really valuable activity. And then we established regular virtual meetings for transparent communication and keeping our staff and cohort engaged. I kind of mentioned this other stuff already. So go ahead to the next slide. A couple things before we turn it over to the others that are going to have some very exciting updates on the scientific side. I just wanted to touch on some of the work that we've added. There's a huge benefit of the genetic advances across the field, being able to get genetic background so quickly with and pretty inexpensively. We've been working to incorporate a genome-wide assessment of an individual's genetic risk for Alzheimer's disease by doing a quick genome screen and then using the risk factors for Alzheimer's disease to adjust the chronological age to the population-based risk that they match for Alzheimer's disease risk. So for example, if a person was 67 years old, chronologically, that's just they were born 67 years ago, but they had a high genetic risk for Alzheimer's disease, they would be having the same risk for Alzheimer's dementia as an 81-year-old who we didn't know anything about their genetics. And so we're looking at this as a possibility for enriching our cohort for risk and being able to understand the factors, not only the genetic factors, but the inheritance factors of Alzheimer's disease. Next slide. The Latino side, I could go very deeply into because there's a whole new world of genetics that is relevant to Latino population. And here we are in San Diego with great access to individuals who would help us understand the specific genetics of Alzheimer's disease in the Latino population. In fact, the genetic diversity in Mexico has as much variety as the European or American genetics is different from China. So that's how much variety is in Mexico itself. And since most of our population in San Diego are from the Mexican Latino community, we think there's a great opportunity to make better understanding of their genetic background and the risk of Alzheimer's disease. Go ahead. We have a new project that is amenable to be done during the COVID pandemic and lockdown while we're still in virtual visits. This is a way to look at the gut microbiome and look at the gut-brain axis, basically what your bacteria in your gut produce in terms of small molecules that are circulating in your blood and how that might relate to risk in Alzheimer's wow. disease. So that's a large study across multiple centers, and we are participating in it. In fact, we're one of the lead centers that initiated it. So I'd encourage you to learn more about this home-based collection of the microbiome, which would advance our understanding of the gut microbiome and Alzheimer's disease. Next slide. And then we just were awarded an imaging supplement. As you guys have known, I've had a lot of interest in looking at the brain using advanced quantitative imaging approaches. And now there's a multi-site endeavor that we were selected as a site for to really supercharge this. And we have funding to do more brain imaging of our cohort, which we're very excited about. Go ahead. And then finally, so important for people to understand how valuable our autopsy consent is because it truly has continued to make advances. And now, again, as I mentioned, genetics are so key to our understanding of Alzheimer's disease that now we can look at our pathological samples in a way that allows us to subsegregate the different cell types that are in the brain and really kind of understand the interplay between these different cell types that are in the brain in Alzheimer's disease and other neurodegenerative illnesses. So I think it just really highlights how important it is for the autopsy samples to be collected at the end of life and how valuable that research continues to be to our center. Thanks very much. I think that's my last slide. I really appreciate your attention. Oh, and I got, I should be watching my time. I do not want to cut into anybody's time and at 10:17, but I will talk a little bit about these submitted questions. Are we doing in-person visits? Very carefully and very slowly and cautiously, and we're watching the surge as it happens, but we have recognized through our clinical practice, which has continued, that we are able to do safe in-person visits with low contact, completely masked. And so for new patients, we have restarted on a limited basis in-person visits, and we feel like we can do that safely. And the vaccine, I hope, will help that improve and ramp back up, because it's so key to our research. How are you keeping participants safe during COVID? I think I covered a little bit of that, basically low contact and dual masking. Will the vaccine impact my participation? Indeed, we believe that it will be a helpful approach to getting our cohort back to in-person visits. And I hope you all are pursuing opportunities to get vaccinated. And I think it's a great way to stay safe from this pandemic. You teach your immune system how to get the jump on this virus. And I think that's very valuable. We're already seeing a drop in infections in healthcare workers because of the vaccine. And I'm very excited about what this brings. How often do I need to repeat procedures for the longitudinal study? Yearly visits, we hope you participate in our ancillary studies that our partner researchers participate in, or that invite you to participate in. We are seeking to collect plasma, I believe every 2 years, I have to look, and but yearly visits for cognition and study. How are you conducting virtual visits, computer versus phone? Some of both, a lot of it is by the phone, because we did do a survey of capabilities of our cohort, and it seemed that most of the cohort certainly was able to be contacted by phone, and we're able to collect a lot of information even by the phone. And so I hope those of you who are familiar with it have found that to be a helpful approach to stay in contact with us. And then, has there been progress in recruiting a diverse sample? We could continue to work on it. It's very key. We are setting up a satellite center in the South Bay to help do research in the community so that the commute is not as far for our Latino population. And with that, I hope I turn it over to the others because I want to make sure we get to all of their work.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Brewer.
Okay. So I'm going to talk to you about an update in biomarkers, in particular progress in cerebrospinal fluid and some exciting developments regarding blood tests. Next, please. These are my disclosures. Next, please. So in general, Alzheimer's disease kind of started out being defined by pathology, and the presence of amyloid and tau are the key lesions at autopsy. There also is shrinkage and loss of nerve cells or neurons. And so this combination of amyloid, tau, and neurodegeneration comes together to diagnose and help to stage Alzheimer's disease pathology. Tau is the basic molecule that makes up tangles. Amyloid is the molecule that makes up plaques. And we have relied on brain imaging and CSF fluid biomarkers to assess A, T, and N. And we're able to do so while people are still alive now. So if we apply this in a research setting, we can come up with some idea of whether someone has Alzheimer's pathology in their brain, but we need to know how they're doing cognitively as well. And so the combination of cognition and biomarkers helps us to achieve clinical staging, as I have set out here. Next, please. So let's talk about detecting amyloid and tau. In this figure, I've shown on the bottom a drawing of what the amyloid molecule looks like. It actually is a molecule that is cut out from a precursor called APP, and we measure fragments of a beta protein in the cerebrospinal fluid that are produced in the brain. Regarding tau, the tau that accumulates in tangles does not completely get out into the brain in one piece. It gets eaten up or processed by a large number of different enzymes. And so we find fragments of tau, and these are some of the fragments that were detected by a particular study. So we've needed to develop specific assays to be able to measure the concentration of these proteins. And regarding CSF, for amyloid beta protein, There are different lengths. They can end at amino acids 37, 38, 40, and 42. A-beta 42 is the bad player, the form that aggregates and builds up in the brain in Alzheimer's. Because it builds up in the brain, then less of it is available to be released into CSF. And so we see a low level of A-beta 42 in CSF and Alzheimer's. CSF tau has all of these different fragments, and levels of many of these are going to be increased in the CSF in Alzheimer's disease. Next, please. So one of the advances for CSF biomarkers has been developing fully automated assays. And there are two of these assay platforms that were submitted in 2018 and 2019 for the beginning of a review by the FDA for potential approval as FDA approved tests. At the moment, we don't have an FDA approved CSF biomarker test. These are the figures show an example of data generated using one of these automated assays from two large studies, one of them in the US and Canada called ADNI, one of them in Sweden called BioFinder. And in the figure, people who have brain amyloid are shown in red as red dots. People who did not are shown in blue dots. This was a classification based on PET scanning. And as you can see, the combination of A-beta 42 and tau, or A-beta 42 and phospho-tau 181, which is one of those many fragments, are both able to classify people who either do or don't have amyloid with over 90% accuracy. Next slide, please. So CSF research has been making all of these advances. What about blood tests? Is it possible that proteins that originate in the brain can be detected in the blood, even though the blood volume is probably 50 or 60 times bigger than the CSF volume, and things get cleared from the blood pretty rapidly? So plasma levels of A-beta and tau are extremely low, which is one of the technical problems. And it's taken a lot of time, but there are new assays using very sensitive methods. And it turns out that we can detect A-beta 42 and different forms of tau in plasma. And in the last couple of years, there have been research data published for A-beta. We need to get the most out of it by measuring A-beta 42 and normalizing it for some other form of A-beta, such as A-beta 40. Just measuring tau on its own didn't turn out to be that useful in plasma, but some of the p-tau, phospho-tau fragments are very useful, as I will show. And there's a protein called neurofilament light that may tell us about neurodegeneration. Next, please. So here's an example of a study, if you push the next one as well, of plasma phospho-tau 217 that was published at the end of last year. And so in one part of the study, as shown on the left, some people who donated plasma also had passed and their brains were examined at autopsy. And it turned out that if you did not have tangles at autopsy, in the brain, then your plasma levels of p-tau217 were low, as shown in orange. If you did have tangles, the levels were higher, and they tended to be higher according to the severity of tangle burden. On the right are a number of different subgroups of patients, and if you can click the next clicker. So these were divided into normals, where plasma p-tau217, shown in the green circle on the left, in normals, levels are relatively low. In people who have Alzheimer's disease, and these were people who may have had MCI or mild cognitive impairment or Alzheimer's dementia, the levels were increased. They were higher in Alzheimer's disease than in with dementia than in MCI, but still gave a useful signal. And then the green circle indicates a number of non-Alzheimer diagnoses, Parkinson's disease, progressive supranuclear palsy, and so forth, where phospho-tau 217 was not increased in plasma. So this looks like a promising, sensitive, and specific marker. Next, please. In another study, it was shown that if one divides up people who are either controls or have mild cognitive impairment or mild cognitive impairment who later progressed to develop Alzheimer's disease and plasma was measured repeatedly over time, in people who were amyloid positive, it turns out that p-tau217 increased over time. And as you can see, the increase is higher in people who had MCI and later converted to Alzheimer's disease. The bottom series of panels shows neurofilament light, where there's a little bit of a signal according to people who had amyloid, but it's a much weaker one. So overall, p-tau217 looks very promising as a biomarker, and there are a number of other plasma biomarkers in development. Next, please. Okay, so I think that's the last of my presentation, and there were some submitted questions that I can deal with, and then if there are any extra questions, we can go through those. So firstly, are blood tests for Alzheimer's biomarkers available yet? The answer is no. Available means available to be measured in a regular hospital laboratory. And at the moment, these are all being done on the basis of research. A couple are being kind of fast-tracked in the hope that they may become available, but not yet. A question about lumbar punctures. I have already completed lumbar puncture for the longitudinal study. Will I have to do it again? You know, there's no have to. We would like people, we would strongly encourage people who did an LP some time ago. So anybody whose LPs were 3 years ago or older, we would really like it if it were possible to get a repeat lumbar puncture. And the reason is that we're measuring some different things in the spinal fluid than we did in the past, but also we need to try to relate the spinal fluid markers to blood tests that we draw, to imaging, and to all sorts of other things that are going on right now. What if I did an LP for another Alzheimer's study at UCSD? Can you share the data to avoid repeating the procedure? The answer is often yes, but it depends on the kind of study. For a clinical trial, we generally can't do this. Clinical trials kind of have a very narrow purpose and don't share with the ADRC. There are some other kinds of studies. So ADNI, there's a all-FTD study and one or two other biomarker studies where we would be able to share data and we quite possibly would be able to share cerebrospinal fluid. And next up, why can't you share my LP results with me? Do the results go in my chart? So the results don't go in my chart, and that's part of the reason we can't share. We are running CSF in our own laboratory, which is a research laboratory. It's not a clinical chemistry laboratory. It hasn't had clear certification in order to serve in that function. And while we think we're doing a good job, without having a certified result, we're uncomfortable being able to give anybody back a CSF result, especially one that was done for research, not to answer a direct clinical question. So I'll stop there and thank you very much. If there are additional questions, happy to deal with them later.
Okay, I think I'm the next speaker. So I'm David Salmon. The next slide. So I just wanted to tell you today about the results of a survey that we did about 3 or 4 months ago that most of you took part in regarding the availability of smartphone and interactive video technology as we were trying to come up with ways that we could adapt to the COVID pandemic. So next slide. So as you know, there was the unexpected emergence of COVID-19, and that led to the inability to do our usual in-person clinical and cognitive assessments. The stay-at-home order commenced in March 2020. That prevented us from doing these clinical and cognitive assessments. And it highlighted the need for us to develop methods that we could easily adopt and administer remotely while the research participant remained safely in their own home or their place of residence where they were living. And of course, remote assessment methods can build upon currently available technologies for real-time interaction using personal computers, tablet computers, and smartphones that we've all become more and more adept at using over the last 12 months. The next slide. So there are a number of potential barriers to widespread implementation of remote online or live interactive testing that we thought about and that we wanted to get more information on. So one is the potential lack of access to reliable high-speed internet service. So if you don't have that, then it would make certain kinds of remote testing particularly difficult. Also, there may be unavailability of personal computers or tablets or smartphone technology. Some cases, insufficient technical skill and being able to set it up and make an appropriate connection. And then just an unwillingness in some people to use digital devices for remote online or live interactive cognitive testing. So we were concerned about each of those potential barriers. And we thought that each of those could vary by age or education or socioeconomic status or even ethnicity. Next slide. So at the time we decided to do the survey, there were 450 currently active participants in the ADRC longitudinal study. We contacted or invited all 450 active participants to complete a survey that assessed their technology access use and willingness to do cognitive testing remotely. The goal of the survey was to give us some information about the feasibility of making a transition to remote assessment, factors that could impact such a transition, and then resources that you might that might be needed in order to make that kind of transition. Next slide. So here's who completed the survey. So as I said, we started off with 450 active participants. All were either contacted by email or by telephone in order to see if they would participate in the survey. I want to thank all of you. We had a very high survey completion rate of 82%. So 369 participants actually completed the survey. We divided it just for our own purposes in trying to understand technology use into people who are cognitively normal and people who had some cognitive impairment or dementia. And in the case of cognitive impairment or dementia, we would also ask the study partner to complete the survey in order to provide accurate information. The next slide. So here's the characteristics of the people who completed the survey. As you can see, in general, the average age of our participants is about 70 years old. We have a highly educated cohort of about, average is a college graduate. About 15% overall of our cohort is self-identifies as Latino. The next slide. And here's the results of the survey you can take a look at. And this is the percent of people who said yes or answered yes to each of these questions. These are the key questions. So it was very encouraging to us to see that about 88% of the respondents reported that they had reliable high-speed internet access. So the vast majority of our participants in the ADRC do have internet access. About 77% also has a computer, a tablet, or a smartphone that has video chat capabilities. 66% regularly use a smartphone, 60% use video chat technology to interact with friends and colleagues, 65% had someone who could help set up a video interaction if it was needed. Importantly for us, about 72% of the people said they would be willing to do cognitive testing that took about an hour or so via a video chat technology. So not only was the access there, the technology available to the people, but they would also be willing to do these clinical and cognitive assessments. We also ask about the possibility of doing some brief multiple episodes of cognitive testing on the smartphone. And about 59% of the participants who responded to the survey said they'd be willing to do that kind of cognitive testing over the smartphone. So the next slide. So we just looked at the responses broken down by whether the participant was cognitively normal or had some cognitive impairment or dementia, because we were concerned that this kind of remote assessment may be fine for someone whose cognition is good, but it may be particularly difficult or not desirable to someone who has dementia. Might not work as well in those cases. And that's basically what we found. People with dementia had less access to reliable high-speed internet. We don't know if that's because they're in residences in some cases rather than in their home. And that makes it a little more difficult to have reliable internet access. But those were the numbers that we saw. Also, there was less accessibility of a computer with a webcam and microphone or a smartphone that could be used for video chats in individuals with dementia. The other point you can see bracketed in red is the people, the participants with dementia were reported that they were less willing to do cognitive testing via video chat. And I believe that's understandable. I think in the case of a person who has moderate to severe cognitive impairment, that kind of impersonal or at least not face-to-face assessment is going to be much more difficult and less desirable for them. And then patients with dementia had less access to smartphone technology as well. So the next slide. So we also looked at it by ethnicity. Because we were concerned about if we begin to do some remote testing, is that going to be more difficult for various groups and really reduce our ability to have good representation of all people in our ADRC? So the two areas that we found differences was that Latina participants had less access to reliable high-speed internet than non-Latinos. Wasn't by a lot, but it was less and something we would have to consider. Also, Latino participants had less access to a computer with a webcam and microphone or a tablet than non-Latinos. What we found encouraging though was smartphone use was not different in Latinos and non-Latinos at all. And willingness to do some brief cognitive assessment on a smartphone was not different at all. So that may be a particular kind of technology that we can take advantage of in the future. The next slide. So, and this is just some information about of those people who indicated they were willing to do some cognitive testing via video chat, what kind of devices and software did they typically use? The device usually used for chat is a desktop or a laptop for most people, about 68% of the respondents. But a smartphone is also available to a lot of people. About half the people said that they often use their smartphone for video chats. There was a little less access to or less use of a desktop or laptop computer by Latinos than non-Latinos for video chat. But there was no difference in smartphone or tablet use in those groups. And then as we've all become more familiar with doing these kinds of video chats, we know the software. So most people tend to use Zoom as their software for chatting. Some people use FaceTime, Skype, and an application called WhatsApp is often used. So the next slide. So what we found was from our survey is that we think the willingness to do cognitive testing via video or smartphone is high among our non-demented participants in our ADRC. It's lower in patients with dementia. We also think the necessary access to the necessary technology is high, but a little lower in Latino participants. So it may take some additional resources to ensure that we can maintain our representative participation in our ADRC, and that if we're using these kind of technologies. Smartphone ownership seems to be comparable across Latinos and non-Latinos, and it may improve access to interactive video technology for cognitive testing. And so based on all of that, we do think remote cognitive assessment could be a practical option for non-demented older adults who are participating in this kind of longitudinal clinical research. One problem we're facing is that the validity of the remote cognitive assessment hasn't been confirmed yet. So is it as effective, is it as valid as doing face-to-face testing? We're not sure about that, but as you can imagine, research centers worldwide right now are trying to make accommodations, have switched over and begun doing some remote cognitive assessment. So we should have a lot of information about the validity and reliability of these methods in the future. And next slide. So if we're able to take advantage of this, what are some potential advantages of remote cognitive assessment? So one is that it could provide access to individuals who might otherwise be excluded from research due to geographical distance or transportation difficulties or physical frailty. So if you are able to do remote testing in your own home, rather than having to come into a research center, it may increase participation. It also permits us to have ongoing participation and follow-up in participants in our study who relocate or travel from the area where they're enrolled. So if someone has been in our research study for many years and decides to move away from San Diego, they would still be able to participate in our longitudinal study by using these remote procedures. Given that, it could also decrease caregiver and participant burden, could facilitate more frequent cognitive assessments, of course, decrease exposure to infectious diseases like COVID, if you're safely in your own home when you're doing the testing. And we think improved access could help diminish health disparities as well by making research available to more people. So given all of that, we definitely plan to continue to do remote assessment even after we are able to reestablish our face-to-face clinical and cognitive testing. We plan to build in some remote testing that we would do in addition to face-to-face testing so that if we're ever faced with this situation again where we shut down, we would have data that's collected remotely that would be continuous from year to year. So I believe that's all I wanted to say. So next slide. So that's the end of the presentation. And then there are a few questions here I can go through. So one is, will I get feedback about my cognitive test results this year? The answer is yes. We'll be sending out our usual kind of feedback letter regarding cognitive testing. It'll be smaller than in the past because we can't assess all of the cognitive domains that we normally do. And there'll be a few more disclaimers than we usually have because, as I mentioned, we're not absolutely sure about the validity and reliability of this form of testing. So we want you to take it with a grain of salt when you read the results. How do telephone assessments differ from in-person assessments? Probably the biggest thing is that we can't do all of the kinds of assessment that we normally do if we're not able to show you various stimuli or word lists or ask you to draw or copy things of that sort. So that makes it more difficult. We have to do a limited amount of testing and not cover all the cognitive domains that we normally do. How long do the telephone assessments take to complete? It's usually from about 30 minutes to 1 hour for just the cognitive assessment part. And then the clinical assessment probably takes about the same amount of time. So there'll be two parts to the assessment that we do each year. How can we tell if my memory has changed based on a telephone call? It becomes more difficult than if we're doing face-to-face testing, but we do have memory tests built into the telephone cognitive assessment. And at least one of the memory tests that we give is pretty much identical to a test that we've done for years face-to-face. So we'll be able to compare your performance in the face-to-face performance on that test versus that same test over the telephone. So we think we'll be able to tell if there's been a change in your memory based on that testing. And then do you plan to continue virtual testing even after we're able to do in-person? And as I mentioned, the answer is yes, we would like to do that. So we'll go back to our regular face-to-face cognitive assessment, but we would still also like to follow that up with some virtual remote assessment that we'll be able to then compare to our face-to-face results. And we'll have as a safety net, if we have to shut down again for any reason in the future, face-to-face testing, we'll be able to continue that remote assessment and have nice longitudinal data on everyone. So those are the answers to those questions. Thanks.
Good morning. This is Howard Feldman at the Alzheimer's Disease Cooperative Study. And for the following few minutes, if we could go to the next slide, I would like to tell you about some of the exciting work that's being done through our group, which is located at the Altman Clinical Translational Research Institute. So on the picture in front of you, on the fourth floor and behind me. Dr. Brewer outlined that in his introduction this morning, and I look forward to telling you about this activity in the coming few minutes. We go on to the next slide. So our work at the Alzheimer's Disease Cooperative Study is in clinical trials. You can see through these disclosures that we have multiple routes of obtaining funding for our trials, some of which comes from sponsors who have compounds and approaches they're wanting to test. Some of it comes through academic investigators with funding through the National Institutes on Health and Aging, and some of it comes through other collaborations. At the present time, we're undertaking 8 clinical trials, 2 observational studies, and 1 platform trial. We cover a broad range of different interventions through the course of this portfolio of different trials. We go on to the next slide. There are 2 things that I'd really like to focus on this morning, and I'm certain that this is of paramount importance to everyone on this call today. One is, when and how do clinical trials translate into treatments that become available to patients, to families that are looking after loved ones with Alzheimer's disease? As you can see in this clinical trial schematic, we conduct clinical trials through what are called various phases, from phase 1 through 2 through 3. You can see the numbers of participants that join trials that enable us to successfully complete a phase. We get particularly excited, as we are presently, when a treatment program reaches the stage of FDA review and approval, what you can see here in purple. And what you can see as a new treatment, aducanumab, which I'll tell you about in a moment, is now in front of the regulators for consideration of approval with a due date of March 2021. I've chosen to talk about this a little bit more this morning than other treatments on the grounds that it will really be in the news in the coming 4 weeks. And it will be of very great importance to all of us to see whether it gets approved or not. I will also mention another treatment, lecanemab, which is in phase 3, but has had some promising results at fairly significant size clinical trial samples. Beyond drug treatments, I also wanted to share with you a new initiative that we're undertaking through the UCSD Center for Brain Health and Memory Disorders. a program called HALT-AD, Healthy Actions and Lifestyle to Avoid Dementia, which has a Spanish translation. It will be a fully bilingual platform. It's done in partnership with Dr. Sarah Banks, who's the co-principal investigator on it. So we'll go to the next slide. So here are aducanumab and lecanemab. They are both amyloid-lowering immune-based therapies. They each are monoclonal antibodies. Aducanumab is a human monoclonal antibody. It has a very interesting development. Someone got the very clever idea that they could look at successful aging, or alternatively, people with very mild Alzheimer's disease that didn't progress, and they could try and figure out what the magic sauce was that helped people either maintain their brain health or have a very benign course of Alzheimer's disease. They then reverse engineered it to create antibodies which could then be infused back into people and would take target of the amyloid protein that Dr. Galasko spoke about earlier. The results in early phase were very exciting. They ended up being published in Nature, which is one of the highest impact journals. You see on the lower panel some of the effects on PET scans. These are the warm colors, so red representing amyloid deposition in the brain. And here you see by contrast to placebo, which continues to have a high amount of amyloid, 3 milligrams per kilogram, 6 milligrams per kilogram, 10 milligrams per kilogram, each showing a dose response relationship in the removal of amyloid. So this is very exciting as a proof of principle that amyloid can be removed from the brain. What made this even more exciting was that there seemed to be some clinical response, again by dose. So a dose response relationship, in this instance, in the CDR rating scale, the clinical dementia rating scale. So out of the phase one data, there was great excitement for this particular monoclonal antibody. As always, in early phase studies, the samples are small. And in this study, there was a high dropout rate. Notwithstanding these caveats, the program went to phase three to two very large studies, Engage and Emerge. Each had more than 1,200 participants. Our site at UCSD participated in the Emerge study and in some of the subsequent longitudinal follow-up. So a particular note of appreciation to those of you that have participated in Emerge. Lecanemab, similarly, is a monoclonal antibody. It is a humanized mouse monoclonal antibody. It also has a high affinity for aggregated amyloid. It had encouraging results in phase two. There were some caveats that I won't go into in great detail this morning, but only to say that as with many early phase studies, there are caveats. But I flag this one because the phase three trials are well underway and they should read out in 2022. With a study being done in those having amyloid but no symptoms in 2024. So let's go on now and consider where aducanumab is and why I'm so interested to tell you about it this morning. So in November, just a few months ago, the Food and Drug Administration, which had received the data from Emerge and Engage, took the view that the applicant, being Biogen, who manufactures this antibody, had provided substantial evidence of effectiveness to support approval based on a clinically meaningful endpoint and reinforced by effects on secondary endpoints and some of the biomarkers that Dr. Galasko spoke about earlier. The FDA, as they are asked to do, is consider whether an expert advisory panel unrelated to Biogen and unrelated to the Food and Drug Administration, were asked to convene in November and vote on a set of four questions. As you can see, the panel voted on the four questions and did not find supportive or strong evidence to any of the questions that they were asked. They advised the FDA to not approve aducanumab until another rigorous trial is done to definitively prove benefit. So now there is a very significant controversy that will resolve itself by March 7th, where the FDA has provided a provisional opinion that they're supportive of approval. Their expert panel has cast doubt on the approvability of this monoclonal antibody. Let's move to the next slide. So where does this controversy come from? Well, it comes from the fact that there were two studies. This is a very busy slide, but what you see are two studies, Emerge and Engage. Each has more than 1,000 participants. And what you can see if you examine these curves, and we've tried to help by putting a star next to where there are significant results, is that for unexplained reasons, the Emerge study was positive on each of its outcomes, the clinical dementia rating scale, the ADAS-COG, and activities of daily living scale, and the mini mental scale. Yet the Engage study did not achieve significant results on any of the outcomes in this study. And this therein lies the controversy and lies the controversy of what to do, where does truth reside? Is it in the Emerge study? Is it in the Engage study? Is it in the aggregate? And what would be convincing to show that this really works? There are a lot of technical details of when the studies were conducted. I won't go into them this morning, but just to leave you with this important impression of one positive study and one negative study. Next slide, please. Next slide. I'm stuck. So the next slide, were we to, am I frozen or?
I think the slides are frozen. One moment.
Okay. I will keep going. So were you to have the slides in front of you, I would be showing you a slide about HALT-AD, which is an educational online platform that we're building with a set of modules that you see in front of you that are going to inform participants about some of the benefits of intervening or risk factors in relationship to optimizing brain health. This will be in English and in Spanish. The goal is that as participants navigate this platform, they will learn it, they will become more literate in dementia risk factors, be motivated to find behavioral change, and empowered to make those changes. Part of the support of this will come through moderated group support and coaching that will be provided by Zoom to give a social component to this program. Next slide, please. No more next slide. Yes, so we can go on to 46 for the sake of time. So this really underscores perhaps a very important point, which is this is the way the platform will be laid out. You see the coaching and you see the idea that we'll be looking from the beginning to the end to evaluate dementia literacy and how this has worked for you as participants. Next slide. What we hope to do with this program is starting with the educational platform, as you can see in the center screen, the HALT-AD platform. Participants will receive back personalized risk profiles that will inform their participation and navigation. And then we hope to have multiple clinical trials that will function for people that participate in this program who can then join specific programs targeting a whole variety of different things, whether they be intervening on sleep, intervening on neuromodulation, on vascular conditioning, on immune factors, on senolytics, on brain energetics, on antioxidants, and on activity. Next slide, please. So we want to skate where the puck is going to be. And what I'd like to leave you with is the idea that we feel the puck is going to be on public health style prevention, as well as effective interventions and treatments. And it looks like we are definitely making progress towards that goal. So next slide. So this is a community affair with recognition of the cast of innumerable and invaluable colleagues that participate in this enterprise. And we'll just go on for a quick minute on those questions that were left. So what do I think the outcome of the adjudication will be? So unfortunately, I moved the crystal ball off my desk. This is going to be very tough for the FDA to decide. I believe that they're going to seek more data than they have available, but I don't know that. And they have already indicated that they may be favorably disposed to approving it. The risks of aducanumab include amyloid imaging related abnormalities. So there can be small amounts of hemorrhage and transient swelling in the brain related to this type of treatment. It is benign. It is sometimes symptomatic with headaches, nausea, but it typically clears over a period of time and treatment doesn't generally need to be stopped, though occasionally it does. The biomarker evidence has shown that up to 70% of the amyloid in the brain can be removed with effective clearance using the monoclonal antibody. The most treatable risk factor to reduce risk of dementia, if we had to put our money down, I would put it on treating systolic blood pressure based on findings from the SPRINT-MIND study, understanding that a targeted systolic blood pressure of 120 looks most efficacious. Other treatments that are coming close, there is a medicine being developed in China, an oligosaccharide treatment developed by Green Valley that looks like it may be symptomatically beneficial with trials being done globally. Have COVID restrictions changed the way we do trials? Yes, we have pivoted, as Dr. Salman has shown. We're using extensive remote testing. And we also have learned that stopping trials is probably the least good option contrasted with continuing them remotely. Are there studies looking at the impact of COVID? Yes, there are multiple studies that are going to be looking at COVID, understanding there's a multitude of risk factors that may be engendered by COVID, including social isolation, loss of active lifestyle, change in diet, and so on. So much attention will focus on COVID. And the question has been touched on already. COVID vaccination will not change your eligibility for trials, but we do encourage COVID vaccination as older individuals are most vulnerable to the ill effects of COVID. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. I'm just gonna jump in real quickly here because I know we're about 5 minutes over the hour, but I would like to invite you all to stay while we do some question and answer if you have the time. If you have somewhere else to be, we do have this recorded and we will be posting it so that you can catch up on the questions and answers later. If you have questions after that come up after this presentation, please do call our front desk, let us know what your questions are. We'll be sure to get them answered either to you directly or in our next newsletter. And you can email us with those questions too at adrc@ucsd.edu. So Tracy, thank you. You're up next and then we'll open the floor. I think our team members have been collecting your questions in chat and we'll help to ask them to the appropriate faculty member that's still available as well. Okay, go ahead.
Hello, everyone. I'm Tracy Truscott, and I'm a social worker at the ADRC. I know many of you. Yvonne Arias and I, she's also a social worker at the ADRC, have talked to many of you one-on-one during this pandemic and realize the social isolation and the disconnectedness a lot of you feel and may feel in the future. Just know that we're here and you can contact us and we can continue to work with you and talk with you. We've posted activities, resources, links to our community partners on our website. Feel free to go there and email us, contact us, and we're here. Our quality of life programs have gone virtual, so we're doing support groups online now. Recently, we started the Memories at the Museum program virtually as well. So that program started in 2007, and it was based on a model after the Museum of Modern Art in New York. And it is for people with dementia and their care partners. We train the docents at the four museums in Balboa Park, and we are now doing that virtually, whereas we used to meet in person for that. So that is also on our website with links to that. It's monthly. You are welcome to join that. The very unexpected, wonderful thing about that is that we have international participation in that museum program now. So we last month, we had people from out of the country joining our group. So it's very interactive, and it's really great. So I'm not going to keep this going because I know we have a lot of questions and answers, but thank you, and contact us.
Thank you. Nadine, I might ask if you and Diane and Dan have questions that you've been collecting during the talk, if you would please ask them and direct them to one of the faculty members.
There are a few questions in the chat regarding Lewy body research. Dr. Glasgow, are you available to give a quick update?
Sure. So what are the questions in particular?
Just if you can, provide an update.
A general update. Okay. So we are doing several different things in relation to Lewy body research. We're working on biomarkers, and there's a very interesting kind of assay that was originally developed using CSF and has recently been extended to look at skin biopsies that can diagnose the presence of abnormal alpha-synuclein in people who have DLB. We're part of a multi-center DLB consortium group, and we're following people with DLB, including imaging and CSF and cognitive characterization. And so if there are folks who are interested in that who are not yet part of that study, we would be happy to be able to tell you more about it. And then there are some ongoing interest in trying to develop clinical trials for DLB. And I'm participating together with folks at other centers in exploring whether there are some new options that might be available. I think that would be a brief summary.
Great, thank you. I also see in the chat a message from Dr. Brewer saying that there has been a recent publication comparing cognitive decline in Parkinson's disease dementia and dementia with Lewy bodies, and he's provided the link there if you're interested. There was additional question regarding the administration of monoclonal antibodies, and if they're IV or orally, and the frequency of administration. Again, Dr. Glasgow, could you address that?
Sure. So antibodies have to be given intravenously. If they're given orally, they will be broken down in the gut. And so they circulate, and they eventually do get broken down through the kidney and liver and other mechanisms. But they usually have a half-life of several weeks. And so in most of the clinical trials of monoclonal antibodies, they've been given at either every 2 weeks or every 4 weeks intravenously. A few years ago, there were some efforts to give one of the monoclonal antibodies subcutaneously, and that seemed to result in reasonable levels. That approach has not yet been developed with the current antibodies that Dr. Feldman was talking about.
There is an additional question that might require a little bit of clarification. The question is, how do we participate in these LB studies? I just want to clarify if this is Lewy body studies or if it's a typo and it should be LP, which is lumbar puncture, Lewy body. Dr. Glasgow, do we have Lewy body studies ongoing at this time at UCSD?
We do. As I mentioned, there is an observational study where we're enrolling, we still are actively enrolling people with Lewy body disease and obtaining imaging and other things. And people could, I guess if they emailed Christina Gelati, they could get an entree into what's going on. Dr. Irene Litvan and I are jointly heading up the study, and Dr. Litvan's study coordinator has been doing the actual recruiting.
Great, thank you. I believe most of the other questions have been responded to in the chat. So if there are any more, please do submit them.
I see a couple early on about LP studies. And again, I'm assuming that's the lumbar puncture. So one is, if LP participants move away, are they still candidates for autopsy?
Well, it kind of depends. And, you know, we would explore it if it depends on where they're moving. If they're moving to the middle of Nebraska, it might be difficult. But if they're moving near another ADRC partner institution, we might be able to pursue such a thing. We've done that for other centers, and maybe they would return the favor, but it depends on what they have in place.
So if somebody moves away, let us know and we'll do what we can. And another is, what other trials besides LP are being conducted?
And on that one, I asked them to get in touch with Christina Gigliotti, okay, because she will have the full gamut. There's a ton of them, and we couldn't go through it in this time. But it's we hope to provide as many opportunities for you as possible. I have one that's doing a lot of imaging and event-related potentials, but there's a ton of them available, and you can look at the gamut by working with Christina.
And they range from development of novel cognitive tasks to lots of imaging and testable olfaction and all kinds of
things. Skirt.
You can find all the current studies also on the website, which was provided in the chat.
Nadine, I was just wondering, did we, about the participating and engage and emerge, if there's any further action or information?
Engage and Emerge are closed at this time. However, there is a follow-up study, which is called Embark, although that is only open to participants who were previously enrolled in Engage and Emerge. So if you did participate in Engage and Emerge and are interested in Embark, please do reach out. You can either email me directly, or you can reach out to the ADRC and I'll be in contact with you. But again, it's only open to participants who were previously enrolled in Embark or Emerge.
Do we want to send the tau question to Howard? Do you have some insight on the therapies and tau pipelines?
So tau is in much earlier days of development. So therapies are probably a decade behind the intensive effort that was put into amyloid therapies. The early readouts of the tau trials have not given us a positive breakthrough yet. There's still a lot to clarify on the target of the tau interventions. So it is still an attractive target, but one that hasn't yet seen a breakthrough.
All right, I think we're coming to the end of this program, but thank you all very much for being here today and for your time and attention, and we look forward to seeing you again soon. Thank you all.
Thank you all. Good to see you.